Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. My name is Adriana Serna. I am the Communications Director for the Caribbean Hotel and Tourism Association. On behalf of CHTA and our strategic partner, OBM International, I'd like to welcome you all to our CAST webinar, Integrated Mosquito Management. And before we present to you today's speakers, we need to go over a few housekeeping items. This presentation is being recorded. We will email to you the video as well as the PowerPoint presentation you will see today, 48 hours after the webinar. You can also access it on our website 48 hours after the webinar at www.caribbeanhotelandtourism.com. After the presentation, there will be a 15 to 20 minute question and answer session. You can submit your questions during the presentation by typing them into the webinar's chat room. Any questions we do not have time to get to will be answered by the speakers after the webinar. The speaker's contact information is on the last page of today's presentation and will be open during the Q&A session. Now I have the pleasure of introducing to you our three expert panelists. I'm going to start with Mr. Ted Worcester. Ted graduated from Cal Poly University with a BS in methodology in 1983. He worked initially as a pest control advisor and operator and joined Univar 33 years ago. He currently resides in Austin, Texas and works at Univar's headquarters. He's currently the manager of Univar's pest control export business as well as product development and registration. Welcome, Mr. Worcester. Now I'm going to introduce you to Raoul Persaud. He is a graduate of the University of Guyana with a Bachelor's of Science in Agriculture. He also holds a Post Graduate Diploma in Agriculture from the University of Greenwich in the United Kingdom. Mr. Persaud has been with Univar for the last 5 years and functions as Univar's sales representative for the Caribbean region. Welcome, Mr. Persaud. And finally, Dr. Remco Suer, I hope I pronounced that to your liking, is a biologist with a PhD in medical entomology. He is one of the three co-founders and co-directors of In2Care, currently responsible for finances, regulations, product management, and logistics. Welcome, gentlemen. So now I am going to turn over the webinar to Raoul Persaud. Raoul, are you there?
I am, Adriana.
Okay, thank you, and please proceed.
Well, thank you very much, Adriana, and a pleasant good morning to everyone who joined us this morning. We would really like to share some insights on integrated mosquito management, especially now with the threat of Zika in the region. So, Adriana, if we may proceed to the next slide, please. Right, so under integrated mosquito management, we can say that this is divided into two areas of responsibility, both the individual and the public. This is a situation where all are involved or all consumed. And integrated mosquito management employs multidisciplinary methodologies and pest management strategies that are practical, effective, to protect public health, the environment, and improve quality of life. Next slide, please. These strategies are employed in concert with insecticide, but they include many other interventions, which include things like source reduction, biological control, and other non-chemical methods. So it's a combination of actions to ensure a successful integrated mosquito management strategy in order for you to achieve success. Next slide, please. And if we just could do a quick review of the general characteristics of mosquitoes. They belong to the order Diptera. They are flies. They are small, long-legged, two-winged insects. They're different from other flies with two main characteristics. And this is the elongate proboscis, the mouth part, and the scales and the wing veins and wing margins. Generally, there are a number of species, but the three main disease-causing species are especially in the Caribbean now, Aedes aegypti, that transmits dengue, quite recently chikungunya, and now Zika. One species transmitting all three of those major diseases. And then, of course, there's the Culex species, which transmits West Nile virus here in the United States. Fortunately, there's no disease transmission at this moment with Culex in the Caribbean. And but of course, this is a nuisance species. And then, of course, we have anopheles, which transmits malaria. Next slide, please. Now, the common enemy, Aedes aegypti, this species is the vector of dengue, chikungunya, and is the one that is causing Zika as well, transmitting Zika. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about why the control of this mosquito is so difficult. Next slide, please. There you have the typical life cycle of an Aedes aegypti mosquito, and you can see from adult, from egg to adult, in a matter of 7 to 10 days, the adults generally live within 2 weeks, between 2 weeks and a month out in the field. Of course, the egg and the pupal and larval stage needs water for them to develop into adulthood. But temperature has a significant impact on the rate of development, and in a matter of 8 days, you can move from an egg to an adult. Next slide, please. So specifically, why this species, Aedes aegypti, the one that causes Zika now, is so difficult to control? I'll just talk about some of their characteristics and some of their unique behaviors. The mosquito is small, dark. There's a white lyre or violin-shaped marking on the thorax, if you look above on the thorax, and of course, their white banded legs. This species is a container breeder, and it prefers man-made containers. They also prefer dark-colored containers, and one of the interventions you'll see later on in the presentation really capitalizes on this feature of this mosquito in that she is a container breeder, and she prefers dark-colored containers. They also breed in natural locations, such as tree holes and axils of plants, leaves, particularly bromeliads. They're very highly adapted to the urban environment. This is an urban-dwelling mosquito. And one key characteristic is skip oviposition, where the female will visit multiple sites to lay her eggs. We already mentioned that the egg to adult can happen in 7 to 8 days. And generally, of course, egg production sites are in close proximity to households. Next slide, please. Now, this is a key characteristic that ensures the survival of this species, making it even much more difficult to control, in that the eggs are resistant to desiccation and can remain viable for 6 months or more. When they're flooded, they hatch, and you have a new generation coming off. The eggs produced depend primarily on the blood meal size. So the bigger the blood meal the female takes, generally she produces more eggs because she needs the protein from the blood to produce eggs. The female can lay 5 batches of 100 to 200 eggs in her average lifetime of 21 days. So when you really work the math, potentially one female can produce 1,000 offspring if all the eggs survive, all the larvae and pupae survive to adult stage. One female can produce as much as 1,000 offspring. Next slide, please. The lifespan of adults are generally about 3 weeks in the wild. They also found in open septic tanks, storm drains, wells, water meters. Key feature, they can breathe in as little as a teaspoon of water. And of course, the biting behavior, this is very important in control, in that they're day biters. They tend to be active just about 2 hours after sunrise and several hours before sunset. They're very sneaky. They approach humans from behind and tend to bite ankles and elbows primarily. And they would also feed on other domestic mammals, domestic animals, mammals such as dogs. Next slide, please. Now, when we come to integrated mosquito management, as I already mentioned, there are a number of interventions that encompass integrated mosquito management. And these include inspection of potential breeding sites, where are these mosquitoes coming from, where are they breeding, where are they developing. Uh, cult, cultural control, which involves elimination of breeding sites. You heard about the big campaigns of tip and dump, tip all containers that are collecting water. There's adulticide, which you kill the adult mosquitoes via thermal or ULV fogging with a pesticide. And then you have barrier treatments, which is essentially treating the areas where mosquitoes tend to rest or hide. Larvicide, which is treating water sources, potential breeding sites with larvicides, which can be either biological or chemical. Of course, the use of repellents to repel mosquitoes. And then there's the latest innovation in the control of Aedes aegypti, a new innovative trap, which Dr. Sur is going to talk about later on in the presentation, the In2Care trap, and how you can deploy these traps on your hotel grounds. Next slide, please. This picture is a typical, demonstrates typically where these mosquitoes can breed. As you can see, in literally every area that collects and holds water for any specific length of time. As you can see, old tires, upturned wheelbarrow, children's wading pool, untreated swimming pool, block guttering, storm drains, bird baths, all of those areas are potential breeding sites. And for example, they recommend that bird baths, they need to be emptied at least every 3 days. When you think of the mosquito's life cycle, you really need to ensure that all sources of water collection are removed or eliminated. Next slide, please. Next.
Yeah, I think we're a little bit slow on the, I apologize. Let's see what we can
do. Oh, that's fine. The internet speed.
There it is.
Yes. It's about eliminating breeding grounds. We need to, commonly overlooked breeding places such as tires, tarps that might be, covering a boat or some other piece of machinery that's collecting water, tanks. Look up. You always need to look up frequently. Check gutters. Remember, this species needs just a teaspoon of water to survive. If you have gutter, it can be challenging. Check odd places like small spaces, between brickwork on the top of walls, and in plants that hold water like bromeliads. I know some hotels in the region are trying to eliminate bromeliads and planting bougainvillea instead. So these are some of the typical areas that you need to carefully inspect. You need to have like a mosquito breeding grounds and special team as part of your team to eliminate the potential breeding sources. Next slide, please.
I'm sorry, it's coming. Promise.
All right, so the best thing to do is to get rid of water permanently. When you can't, for example, like in drains, you can pour a salt solution into the water, Aedes aegypti. Mosquitoes do not like salt water, so they will not breed in that. Or you can add fish to the water, biological control such as guppies. Next slide, please. This may not be your property, the picture to the left. But this is a tip. This could be an adjacent property to your property, and look at the potential breeding sites. Literally, everything in that picture is collecting water. 6 to 8 days, you have a new population of mosquitoes coming off, and that is a tremendous breeding site. So, if you can clean up that area, inspect the adjacent property next to yours as well. Get everyone involved to eliminate breeding sites is so absolutely essential. The picture on the right is typical of a tire dump, where used tires are just dumped willy-nilly. Ideally, those should be removed, either buried or completely shredded. But look at potential breeding areas for mosquitoes development. Next slide, please. Another temporary breeding site, water collecting in a depression. Great potential for mosquito population explosion. Next slide, please. And then, of course, in all aspects of control, you need to consider physical barriers. There's special mesh, whether fiberglass or galvanized or aluminum mesh, that you can mesh windows and doors to prevent the entry of mosquitoes into a dwelling, dwellings or building out of areas of human habitation. Of course, there can be bed nets. Remember, this particular species is a day biter, Aedes aegypti, so bed nights at night may not prevent you from getting bitten. If you sleep in the daytime, consideration sleeping under a bed net, especially pregnant women. And typically, water storage areas, you know, like drums and bats, etc., they need to be protected with meshing to prevent mosquitoes entering to breed. Next slide, please. Of course, the use of repellents goes without question. Repellents applied generally do work. In2Care has a natural repellent for those people who do not like DEET or strong chemicals like DEET. In2Care has a natural repellent based on African eucalyptus oil, which repels mosquitoes for 4 to 6 hours. So once you're outdoors, it's essential that you protect, you know, yourself and protect your guests. And a cool idea can be to, upon checking your guests, you can, when your guests check into the hotel, a cool idea can be issue them with a bottle of repellent for their own personal protection. Next slide, please. Now, when we have eliminated all potential breeding grounds, the next action that we can consider is adulticiding. And adulticiding is really trying to, with the use of a pet, adulticiding is application of a pesticide to target adult mosquitoes. And this can be achieved with equipment such as ultra-low volume or thermal foggers. Next slide, please. So the definition of adulticiding is where you use an insecticide to kill adult mosquitoes. You need to consider that ULV or fogging applications must be done while the mosquito is active and airborne. Adulticiding is generally used to dramatically reduce adult mosquito populations. And there are a wide selection of foggers available. Depending on the size of the task, you can choose from handheld units to ATV mounted machines, all the way up to truck mounted machines, both thermal and ULV foggers. Next slide, please. Now, not everything needs to create a smoke cloud, because only thermal foggers create attention drawing clouds. You can consider for your property a less obvious ULV application. And in extremely sensitive areas, there are also electric machines that you should you decide to use this stealth mode. Next slide, please. Thermal fogging, there you see a picture of a handheld thermal fogger in operation. One great thing about this is that the thermal fogger produces very tiny droplets that is able to penetrate foliage, trees, tall weeds, in areas that mosquitoes typically tend to hide or rest or dwell. And this fogger produces tiny droplets that are able to impact those adult mosquitoes. I must caution, however, that this is just a temporary intervention. There is no prolonged treatment. Generally, the droplet produced by the thermal fogger must come into contact with the adult mosquito before that mosquito would die. So this is no extended protection. It's just an immediate intervention and a short the mosquito population. Next slide, please.
Give it a minute, it's a little slow. I'm so sorry.
And we don't have control over the webinar. Examples of thermal foggers by one manufacturer called Curtis Dynafog. The one at the top is the Superhawk XP. The one at the bottom is the Golden Eagle. These are widely used by vector control units in the Caribbean for thermal fogging. And we will definitely be able to share our post-webinar a lot of information to use and operate these machines, etc. So those are classic examples of handheld thermal foggers. Next slide, please. Now, the question is ULV versus thermal fogging. Is there a difference? You know, they have a public, generally, thermal foggers produce a lot of clouds and smoke. You're able to, there are a lot of advantages and disadvantages of both methods, but the thermal foggers, you're able to guide the fog, and you see the fog, you're able to guide the fog into the target areas because you see the fog drift. The ULV fogging is much more subtle. It's a cold fog, and it's generally undiluted insecticide that is released to the atmosphere. So there are a lot of advantages and disadvantages. Some people might feel that, hey, if we don't see the smoke cloud, it means that the procedure, the intervention is not working. But that is not quite true, because both methods, thermal fogging and ULV fogging, have their advantages and disadvantages. But again, this is solely aimed at controlling the adult mosquito population. Next slide, please. And in terms of adulticide options that are available, the Univar has a unique brand in Masterline Control 44, Masterline Aqua Control, Masterline Control 3030. These products are based on pyrethrin, Masterline Control. Oops. Adriana, hello?
Yes, sir.
I have lost the screen completely.
Oh, it's up there.
I'm not sure.
Can everyone see it? Raise your hands virtually, please, if you can see the screen. Okay, getting lots of hands in the air, which is good.
Let me go ahead and, if it's all right, Raoul, I'll go ahead. I see it still. Let me go ahead and take over, if that's okay.
Okay. I appreciate it if you can take over. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. You're welcome.
Anyway, thank you for joining. To go over this, the adulticide, the Masterline Control 4-4 is made to be used without dilution. You don't have to dilute it with anything. It's the right concentration as either a thermal or a cold fog, ULV thermal fogger. Masterline Aqua Control is only as a ULV. It's got its water base, can be mixed with water, etc., but it is water-based with ULV. So without going into too much detail, they're permethrin-based products. There are several permethrin-based products. Permethrin is a pretty steady, good option as far as controlling mosquitoes. There are other pyrethroids out there. There's straight pyrethrin that can be used, really expensive. It's quick knockdown. But in all these cases that you're seeing here, with the exception of the last couple, they're only made to last a few hours. As Raoul was indicating, they're made to knock down the population, get it under control, but the next couple of days, you're going to have, it doesn't affect the larvae, the next few days, you're going to have larvae becoming adults. So it's a good, quick knockdown and a very, very good one with the machines and the products that we've got today. It's kind of the standard of the industry, if you will. Malathion is an organophosphate that's been around for many years. It lasts a little bit longer. It's also been used very widely, very relatively safe as chemicals go as compared to other organophosphates. And then Nalid is for a lot large scale helicopter fogging, etc. But it's extremely good product. Has to be done by commercial applicators, and that's when an entire area, a large area, has gotten out of control. Next slide. And here's the pictures of some of the products that we have, the Control 4-4 at the top there, Aqua Control, etc. The Malathion in the form of Phytonon down below. The Prentice is probably the pyrethrin products. I can't read it. And the Zenovix is a fairly new product. It's also a pyrethroid that's made for quick knockdown of mosquitoes with minor problem with other species or other insects. The times that you tend with fog and with the fog are usually at times when bees and things are not out. Unfortunately, fogging during the day, for the day biters, if you're fogging during the day, the bees are out, so you have to be very careful when you do this. Generally, fogging is done in the evening or in the early morning hours before the sun breaks, before the bees start running around. Next slide. ULV application. ULV sprayers apply second-formless compressing and diluted insecticide formulations as very fine droplets using no water to dispense the material. So your ULV foggers, there is a water-based one, the Aqua Control 3030, but they're just small particles. They're not burned, whereas the thermal fogger will actually burn the oil in it, making that smoke. The smoke, the thermal fogger, is very good, actually better at penetrating. But as you can see from the amount of smoke, you have to be careful where you use it, because the guests see those clouds coming, they're going to think it's going to rain here pretty quick, because it makes a very thick cloud as it goes through. But it's very, very effective on a thermal fogger. ULVs, like Raoul was saying, is less invasive. It has a little bit different materials and different equipment that would to be used for it. Next slide. This is the typical truck ULV. This would be probably from a commercial unit. Either a large hotel or a mosquito abatement district is using these. And these are the ones that will typically go through the neighborhoods, et cetera, and dusk or dawn, that will go ahead and put these out before people are running around, bees and other insects are running around. But it's typically when mosquitoes start running around. It'll hang out there for a couple hours, two, three, 4 hours, and then they either dissipates or the or it'll be a UV will break it down, etc. Next slide. And these are other machines. This is also Curtis. We represent two or three lines, but Curtis is the main. We also represent London Fog, which is up there. I believe that to the right. But Curtis is the main line that we represent. They come different sizes, different applications, etc. They'll come on carts. They can be pulled around. They'll put on truck mounted. We even have some backpack ULV foggers that I'll show you in just a second. Next one. All right, we'll get to the backpacks here in a second. Probably one of the primary ways that most pest control operators control mosquitoes, in fact, the primary way is that they use will do one of two things. They'll make sure that the breeding sources are eliminated as best they can, and then they'll put barrier treatment on there. And barrier treatment is typically put where the mosquitoes are resting. In other words, around the property, on the edges of the property, and we'll show you some areas on this. But mosquitoes will typically rest during between flights. They'll rest on plants, and in particular on the underside of leaves, in decks, things like this. They'll be resting on there. So if you put a barrier treatment on there, and that barrier is residual, in other words, a product that's going to last for a while, it's a very good way of trying to keep the mosquitoes from going into an area. When we've done the recommendations before in hotels, we've recommended treatment with the In2Care and some of the other treatments we've got, but a lot of times, and Remco will go into this, Dr. Suer will go into this in more detail, we'll recommend a barrier treatment along the edge, because you'll have mosquitoes and sources outside your hotel. It gives enough of a barrier to when they land, and if the product is correct and works as quickly as it should, then you're going to kill the mosquitoes before they have a chance to come get your guests. Next slide.
Excuse me, Ted. Actually, I think Raoul is back. His computer was on power save mode. Do you want to continue, or would you like Raoul to take over again? Do you want to go ahead?
I believe this is my section anyway, so I'll go ahead and continue.
Fantastic. Great. Go ahead.
This is one of the pictures of a barrier treatment. This is from a gas-powered unit. They're pretty loud, but they do a pretty effective job. They'll get up to 15, 20 feet up in the air, and some of your canopies you'll need to get to 15, 20 feet with some of these mosquitoes. The Culex or the 80s will be resting in the leaves in between traveling. So this is a good one to use. I believe this is the Solo unit. Next slide. Okay, barrier treatment. Use a barrier treatment as part of a containment strategy. Barrier trap applications lay down contact residual in areas where adult mosquitoes roost. And it's important, the residual that you use is important. You can't, you know, you're going to get different results with different residuals. Bifenthrin is a very good residual. It's kind of a common chemical. It is a pyrethroid. It lasts for several days, if not a week and a half or so. It's one of the less expensive pyrethroids. It works pretty well. It knocks them down fairly quickly, and it'll last, like I said, a week and a half, 2 weeks. However, whatever product you use is going to have to do two things. It's going to have to last as long as possible, and that means protection against UV, moisture, things like this, be able to stick on the leaves, knock down mosquitoes, get them knocked down in several minutes, because if it doesn't knock them down for a couple hours, they can continue to bite guests before they die. So using the right residual is also important. Masterline bifenthrin is one. It's like I said, it's a bifenthrin product. There's microencapsulated products. Probably the best in the market today is a product called Demand. It's microencapsulated lambda-cyhalothrin. But it works extremely well and lasts over a month. It makes a great barrier. Now you try a dual action, they're actually putting the growth regulator pyroproxifen in it. So if you use a Demand, you use a pyroproxifen in the form of Archer or whatever, you can do that. And you're actually putting a pyroproxifen out in the environment. Pyroproxifen will get in some of these areas that have water, and only takes a couple tablespoons of water here and there to breed the Aedes aegypti. It'll get in the areas, and the pyroproxifen will get on the those areas and actually keep the larvae from becoming an adult. Next slide.
It's coming.
Okay. I think we have a couple of examples of machines coming up here that you can use or that your staff can use. Well, like I said, this is this machine that you're seeing until the new slide. This is also the Solus, the gas-powered one. Raoul had mentioned there's electric-powered ones. One is called the Boston Fog. It's fairly new. It's coming up. But depending on the time of the day you're doing, if you're fogging in the middle of the day, or if you're fogging close to guests, you want to use something with a little less noise. Here we go. It requires equipment such as sprayers or mist blower. And the mist blower, it's important. We've talked about the different fogs or the different treatments. You have the smoke, which is the finest particle. It floats. It lasts a while, and it's very active because it's just been released and it's been burned. Then you have ULV. It's a little bit bigger droplet size. It's not nearly necessarily made to adhere to leaves and things like this. It doesn't generally do that. A little bit, but not a lot. And then this one is a mist. It's a little bit bigger droplet. The whole point of a mist is to get it on and get a very, very slight wetting underneath the leaves or on top of the leaves on the plants, the decks, things like this. We're going to be showing you the whole purpose of that is to get that wet. And then once it dries, those particles are still sitting there. The mosquito lands, and within a few minutes of landing on it, hopefully they're either sick or dying or dead. It consists of focusing on residual treatment mosquito resting sites, generally applied around buildings, walls, plants, especially the underside of leaves, like I said several times, under decks, tables, chairs, and other shelter-protected areas. So anywhere that's shaded, that's quiet, the mosquito can rest during the day or during the night, depending when they're resting. That's where you want to try and get this the best you can. Next slide. Okay, here's a picture of the Solo on there, and you can see that mist is blowing, coming out there pretty strong on there, and it needs to, because you're going to need to get up the canopy up there, like I said, that 15, 20 feet at a minimum, to be able to get all the resting areas. The mosquitoes usually don't go higher than about 15 or so feet, but they will roost or rest higher if necessary. Next slide. These are relatively new units that were developed specifically for mosquito control and specifically recently because of the outbreak, primarily of chikungunya and things like this. That they're a lot more people are looking at the equipment. These are called the Boston fog, as you can see. And the one on the left is made for very small areas. It's the tanks on there. And what you've got is you've basically got a blower, and then you've got a valve set up, an electric set up, it's electric fogger, but you've got a valve on there that injects the little bit of material, residual material, water and residual material, into the air. So basically, they've adapted the blower to make it into a mister, which is what most misters do. That one in the left, top left, is for small areas. The one on the right is the one we recommend. It's a lot easier to use, and it continuously puts the residual in the air as you're using it, and it's a much easier one to use on there. So those will get up to 15, 20 feet also. Those lithium batteries will last about an hour and a half of fairly continuous use to 2 hours of continuous use. So we recommend that you get a backup battery and have that charge go. And most of the units will go a full day, or pretty close full day, on and off with two batteries. Much quieter. You can put these out. I don't know if you've ever used a rechargeable a blower, but that's the sound it's going to make, as opposed to an engine, a gas engine on it. Next slide. Barrier treatments, the lower parts of fences, more areas, lower parts of the fences under vegetation, dark, humid areas, outdoors, surfaces near breeding areas, has significant value in an integrated pest management program, as Raoul had said earlier. Next slide. Okay, and here's the insecticides. I talked about the mash line, bifenthrin, demand CS. Archer is the additive to it. There's other products, Suspend, Tempo, Zenovex, can all be used to make a nice barrier. And what's good on just about all these products is they're very, very active on diptera, mosquitoes, and flies. And we'll give a very quick knockdown. And you're putting it in the place that they rest, not where a lot of other insects, in particular bees, tend to rest. Because bees will go after flowers. Bees don't render on the other side of the leaves. Next slide. And here's the pictures of the products that we just talked about. I think the only extra one up there is Maverick. Maverick, another pyrethroid, doesn't last quite as long, but still relatively good and relatively inexpensive to use on there. The most expensive would be the Polyzone and the Demand, but those two are the ones that will last quite a bit longer because they're microencapsulated. Basically, they've taken the chemical, very active on mosquitoes, and very active mosquitoes, and they've encapsulated that so it lasts that 4 to 5 weeks time period out in the Caribbean. Next slide. And use of personal protection equipment, we can't emphasize this enough. No matter what you use, no product is perfectly safe. A lot of these things, the toxicity of the products have dropped dramatically over the past couple of decades, and they're much, much safer than they used to be. However, nothing is perfectly safe. Salt in the right amount can be toxic. So personal protective equipment, especially if you're using the adulticide foggers, is going to be extremely important, especially for the breeding apparatus. And now you tell us the breeding apparatus is working. They're carbon-based. We recommend carbon-based. Most of them are carbon-based. And if you put that on there, you test it. If you can smell the chemical or if you can taste it, it's not working. If it is working and the filters are fitted correctly, the mask is fitted correctly and the filters are working, then it'll take the odor out there because the odor is organic and the carbon filters are organic materials. Next slide. Okay, growth regulators. Again, Univar sells these. Other people sell these growth regulators, so I'll talk about them in general. Altacid is the one that's probably been around the longest. It's a methylprene product, and it comes in several different varieties. It comes in granules that you can put in small areas. It comes in briquettes, dunks, etc. So it comes in a lot of different ways that you can put in there. It's got a time release, and very, very, very little growth regulator will kill a lot of larvae, so it doesn't take much to do this. Novaluron is relatively new, and then the pyroproxifen is probably the one that is one of the other main growth regulators in there. The pyroproxifen is actually approved by WHO to use in drinking water, potable water. So it's a very relatively safe product that only affects mosquito larvae. And it's important to know that pyroproxifen works in extremely small amounts. Up to 8 to 10 parts per billion will give you control and keep a mosquito larvae from becoming an adult and kill it. BTI is Bacillus thuringiensis. It's a spore that is put in the water, and it's very specific to diptera, in particular mosquitoes. There are some species of BTI that will affect other insects in the water that go into the water, but in the case of this particular strain, it goes primarily after mosquito larvae. It attaches onto them. It parasitizes the mosquito larvae to the point it kills it. And it's a relative of using product. Comes in dabs, etc. There's also toxicants. Temifos is an organophosphate. We don't sell that into the Caribbean, so I'm going to go through that pretty quickly, except to government agencies. So it's an organophosphate. It's very, very mosquitoes or larvae are very susceptible to it. And then there's monomolecular films. Mosquito larvae, when they're in the water, they don't breathe the water. They're not like fish. They don't have gills. They have a tube. They have to have oxygen from air to be able to. So even though they live in the water, they have to breathe air. So what a monomolecular film does is it puts a very, very slight film on the top of that water that really suffocates the mosquito. That tube can't break. It makes the surface tension of the water so that tube can't go through the water surface and be able to get air. So it will kill larvae in very large scale areas. You can use, there's several films that you can use. There's oils, there's aquatane, which we'll go over, et cetera. But putting a very small film on there, and you have minimum effect on everything else around it, no effect on fish, et cetera, depending on what you're using, but it will kill the larvae and it's in the water, the wigglers. And then, of course, Raoul mentioned salt. Salt can be used in certain areas when you can find it. Small areas, obviously, you can't salt in the same with Altacid. Aquaback is the BTI. We have the master line control larvicide. That's basically an oil with a surfactant in it that can be used in certain areas that will suffocate the mosquito. That's the monomolecular film. And on the bottom right is another form of BTI in the form of dunks that can be put in the bodies of water that will release that spore that kills the mosquitoes. Next slide. On the top left, he looks like he's doing some type of fogging material. On the dunk, that's with the guy that looks like a donut, that's a dunk, can be put in bodies of water that slowly releases over 30 or 60 days or a couple of weeks, depending on the dunk that you've got, and they'll slow release the BTI. You can put BTI granules. In this case, it's probably they come in granule form also in the upper right. Then you can see the guy is putting it in a storm drain. So it's going to release BTI on those granules. The granules release quicker, but they'll still release over a few days. In this case, it could be using granule alticid or the BTI in the bottom left. But those are the areas basically that you want to cover. And in the bottom right, they're putting a little bit. It could be a monomolecular film, either an oil or the aquatane that's coming up. They're putting a film over an area that's a bigger area that will suffocate and kill all the larvae that's existing there right now. And it'll last. And those films, oil will last a few days at best, a couple, two, 3 days at best. The aquatane will tend to last about 2 to 3 weeks, which I'm going to go over with you. But it will suffocate the larvae for that amount of time, keeping them from becoming adults. Next slide. Okay, aquatane is a unique silicone-based liquid barrier. It self-spreads across the surface very, very quickly. It spreads. It's amazing how fast it will spread. Totally non-toxic, physical action. It's not chemical in the fact that it's a silicone-based. But silicone is all over out there. Sand is silica, by the way. So it's kind of it breaks down into kind of an inert natural. I'll say aquatane while I'm waiting for the slide. Aquatane was developed in Australia, and it's sold, and we have testing all over the world on the aquatane in different areas, Kenya, et cetera, for different species of mosquitoes. And it's done extremely well on there. And it's good for large areas, but they've also recently developed part of one of the products to do smaller areas. To be able to do small areas. So instead of putting salt on something, you might be able to use one of these drops. As soon as the slide is changing, there we go. All right. So anyway, you can see how quickly the aquatane, where that water is rough is where the aquatane is not and it's spreading. So just in a few minutes, when you put an application this into that pond, it's almost reached the other end of that pond in a few minutes. So now that water, it's broke the surface tension, so those mosquito larvae are now starting to suffocate. Next slide. And it's effective in all the major mosquitoes, aegypti. It's also effective in Aedes albopictus. I don't know if there's albopictus down in the Caribbean. I know that the Asian tiger mosquito is all over the southern U.S., but we've got some 80. We've got both the aegypti and the albopictus. The Culex quint is also effective on that for the West Nile virus and also the anopheles. It's been tested on all three, and all mosquito larvae are the same. They have to have those breathing tubes. Next. Must be more pictures. All right. As you can see, what it does is it'll also actually drown the mosquitoes. If she lands on the water or into the water or the eggs get in the water, they'll actually, because the surface tension is broken, the eggs, and sometimes the female mosquito will drown too, but certainly the eggs will drown or will go under the water as well as the larvae and the pupa. None of them can break the surface tension. Next. It lasts for 3 to 4 weeks. I'd probably give it about a week less than that. And this is the form. These, to me, remind me of vitamin E pills. They've got a water-soluble coating on it, but that's aquatine, obviously, in the middle of that. It's called dengue drops. So these drops can be placed in a bromeliad or something, some place where you can't really get rid of the water, you can't turn bromeliad over, it's going to collect water, trees, knot holes in trees, things like this. You can drop one of these in there, and this will break the surface tension of that water and keep the mosquitoes from breeding in that particular area. So they're nice for small areas as opposed to putting salt in there. Salt works too, but as opposed to putting salt, you can put this on there and it will last. And when water comes out, there's still material in there, et cetera. And with that, I will go ahead and turn it over to Dr. Suer and let him talk about the In2Care trap and kind of, you know, he'll probably bring and incorporate a couple of the barrier and the aquatane strategies, because once you put these together, you get pretty doggone good control. We've had lots of luck in other hotels in knocking down the mosquito populations to the point where the guests weren't bothered. Dr. Suer?
Yes. Next slide, please. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for having me join this webinar and giving me the opportunity to explain a little bit about In2Care, who we are, what we stand for, what we have developed, and in more particular, the In2Care mosquito trap, how it works, and how it would be useful to you. Next slide, please. Very briefly on In2Care. So it was founded in 2011, so we're quite young, by three scientists with a PhD in mosquito research. And in addition, we have now a person in our team who is a serial entrepreneur, putting in more than 100 products in the market, and an experienced salesperson. Together, we have more than 30 years of experience in mosquito science. The motivation driving our company is really to provide solutions for people suffering from diseases transmitted by insects and predominantly by mosquitoes, because that's our cup of tea, so to say. And we, to reach the masses, we think we need to make a product that is easy in user-friendly, easy to use, and relatively cheap as well. In our short existence, we have received support from various quite good organizations like the UBS Optimus Foundation. The European Union has given us a grant, the Human Development Innovation Fund, for example, and last year, November, we have received a $10.2 million grant from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to prove that our intervention against malaria mosquitoes really lowers the population of the amount of malaria cases. And we're doing a very large phase 3 trial now in Ivory Coast on that one. Next slide, please. So these are the three products we have up until now. The mosquito trap, which I will discuss in more detail later on. The Eve tubes, which is basically a tube which we put in a wall, and we cover the hole with a piece of netting. And on the netting, we can have actives on there, various actives, and it works really well. And then we have the box shield repellent, which is presented already by Raoul, which is a natural-based ingredient. To go on to our mosquito trap. Oh, yes, thank you. I hope some of you have seen the animation already. If not, please do. It is a very, it's a four-minute animation really explaining in detail how our trap works and what you can expect of it. I will summarize it now in a few sentences. We have what you see in the middle is the trap, which is sort of a flower pot with a lid on, but it is quite nifty on the inside. We have a water in the pot because we target egg-laying female mosquitoes. In the water, we have a yeast tablet which produces odor in the beginning and food for the larvae later on. On the water surface, we have a floater. On the floater, there's a piece of netting which you will see in the on the left side with a little bit of white. The white is the actual the powder on the netting. The net has an electrostatic coating which adheres powders to it. We lure a mosquito in, the female mosquito, and make her land on the netting. Once she lands, she picks up two powders. One is the larvicide pyrotropin, and the other one is a biological fungus that kills the adult mosquitoes over time. Combination is really nice because we let the mosquito fly out of our trap. Why do we do that? Because she has the pyrotropin on her legs. And using the skip of a position behavior, which Raoul has explained earlier, She lays her eggs in multiple sites, but she has the pyrotoxin on her legs, and the very low amounts necessary to kill other larvae ensures that she's just spreading the larvicide to the breeding sites we can't find. So she's actually spreading pyrotoxin to all the small breeding sites you see here. Of course, we don't want to have the adults flying around and transmitting diseases as well, so the fungus comes in. The fungus really kills the mosquito over time. It takes 7 to 10 days to kill the mosquito, and they do that by growing slowly inside the mosquito and killing it from within and releasing various toxins. So chemical of the resistance of the mosquito against the fungus is not non-existent. And the spores, they only adhere when they come into contact with an insect skin or a mosquito skin, not with humans. So it's perfectly safe for humans. Basically, this gives us the opportunity to kill adult mosquitoes. We kill all the mosquito larvae in our trap, get 100% kill, but it also spreads the pyrotoxin to other breeding sites, killing mosquito larvae from this mosquito and the other larvae in the same breeding sites. And in the other event, because we're killing the mosquito with the fungus, we're preventing the virus transmission by the adult mosquito. Next slide, please. So what do we have? Do we have any scientific evidence for this? Yes, our base of the company is scientific, so we have published already our lab results. Some of the pictures you see of the setup we use on the top in two well-known peer-reviewed journals. We have done registration trials, semi-field trials. These are large-scale experiments outside. For example, for the US EPA, we've done these tests in Manatee County, Florida, where we tested it against all the Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus, which are the main targets of our trap. We've also done already two large-scale field trials where we compared an area without traps with an area with traps, and we used about 200 traps in that area. And we've done that in Trinidad, which was independently done by the Ministry of Health, and we've done that in Grand Cayman Islands. Next slide, please. Here you can see a little bit of the evidence. It's about the only graphs I will show. So what we have proven up until now is that the traps are attractive to Aedes aegypti and albopictus. Like Raoul mentioned in the beginning, the large, dark form trap really adds to the attractiveness combined with the odor. It works really well. So we kill all the mosquito offspring in the trap, 100% kill. And we do that in a nifty way. Pyrotoxin kills the larvae at the moment they are transforming into pupae, which transform into an adult. That means you will see live larvae in the trap. But live larvae for our trap is a really good thing. Live larvae give odors that signal to female mosquitoes that this is an attractive breeding site because the larvae have already grown. So they actually pick up these larval odors and they enter the trap and lay more eggs in there. So it's actually a good thing that you will see live larvae in there. And we have proven in various tests now, both lab, semi-field, and field, that we can spread the pyrotoxin to other breeding sites. This is what you will see in the graph. The blue bar represents the normal mortality in a breeding site. If you do nothing, you have just your control a bowl of water, and you count your larvae, you see how many will emerge as adults, then you get 20% kill, so 80% will become an adult. If your bowl is standing in the vicinity of our trap, we get 80% reduction, so 80% of the mosquitoes won't hatch, and this is in breeding sites around our trap. In the small picture, you can see the setup, our trap in the middle, with other breeding sites around it, and if your mosquito first visits our trap and then visits the small breeding sites around it, the larvae in the other breeding sites, they will die. Next slide, please. And we have proven now that in, for example, Cayman Islands, we get similar results. You see that in the open field, in the area without traps, you had about 10% kill in other breeding sites. Well, we get 60% kill in the breeding sites around our trap. Next slide, please. So Until now, the Integrated Mosquito Trap has already been approved for sale in 23 countries, which you will see here in green, and registration is ongoing in more than 25 other countries worldwide. The blue countries are countries where we expect to have registration in about 3 months, the red ones in 6 months, and I am very pleased to announce that just very recently, this week, we heard that the US EPA has approved our trap for deployment under the Section 18 exemption, where the PCOs and the CDC, Center for Disease Control, can actually use our traps to control Zika. Next slide, please. Although we have a very nice trap, it's always better to use multiple methods, and integrated mosquito management is the only way to go about it if you really want to do it well. So what we see as the best strategy would be what we call SLAP, which is surveillance, the source reduction, larval control, adult control, and public awareness. Our trap targets the source reduction, the larval control, and the adult control, added with the measures that Chad and Raoul already talked about. Next slide, please. Okay, so what we have done, we've sort of written down the operational steps, for example, for maintenance staff in hotels, or we also have one more target for the PCOs. If you can do it yourselves, this might be the way forward. Otherwise, I would suggest to hire the pest control operator if they, for example, already visit your hotel for other pests, cockroaches, or bed bugs, or even rodents or anything. This might be just an add-on for them. So the operational steps first would be just to identify your target, and I will explain them in a little bit more detail next on. Then second step would be map your target area and the surrounding area, identify high-risk locations, clean up and treat as many breeding sites as possible, place the traps, and then monitor and maintain them. Next slide, please. The first step is the identify your target, which is very difficult but really essential. What you can see here are three main species, Aedes albopictus, Aedes aegypti, and you also have Culex. Culex, like Raoul mentioned, is more a nuisance mosquito. They tend to have different breeding cycles, tend to have different places where they put their eggs in. Identifying the species is key, because then your method of choice and how to target them can differ also a little bit. Next slide, please. One example which we found is that, for example, there is your Aedes aegypti with the lyre on his thorax, the lyre-shaped white stripe. You have Aedes albopictus, which has just a straight line on his thorax. And then you have Aedes teneoringus. Different mosquito, really looks the same. It's a sibling, but it doesn't transmit diseases. But it is a nuisance, and it doesn't use containers to breed. If you are bothered by this mosquito, our trap is not the best solution. Then probably the fogging, the thermal fogging, or the ULV are the better choice, because they breed in more open areas and marshes, because it's the black salt marsh mosquito, in more open waters, so no container breedings. So that's why I mean that identify a target is really important. Next slide, please. The next step is to map your target area and surrounding area. By mapping it, I mean just taking the size, the vegetation, where are the water bodies, and do you see mosquito breeding sites? Check for the known types of hotspots for mosquito breeding. I will show some examples in the next slide. Map these active breeding sites, sites where you see the larvae, because that's very important. You can then indicate if they are small or large, and if they are removable or not. And also think about if this is a small ball type of element, can it be filled up with rain after the rains, because then you might have a reinfestation. And then, like Ed and Lou already mentioned, check your borders because of the risk of influx. A mosquito can fly 100 to 200 meters easily. So if you do your job really well, but your neighboring area is really filled with junk or car tires or anything, then it is really smart to either try to see if you can do source reduction there, or if not, try to place a barrier screen around it to protect your guests. Next slide, please. You will see here in the next slide the examples of hotspots. For example, areas with potted plants, the rain gutters. All areas with water in the vicinity are potential breeding sites. Because of the skip over position, they like to have multiple areas with water in the vicinity. And remember, mosquitoes have a memory. So if there are a lot of areas with water, they will return there. If you can remove them and place a trap, it will enhance the mechanism of the trap. The backside of kitchen ovens and garbage areas. Also take a notice of the septic tanks and other sewage elements. Often these are not Aedes mosquitoes, but Culex mosquitoes, but your guests won't be telling the difference and they just don't want to be bitten. So if you can take these out as well, that would be great. The third step is a more difficult one. It's the next slide, please. That's the identification of high risk and low risk areas. And by that I mean that you have high risk areas. These are areas where you have more mosquitoes, there is vegetation where they can hide under, there is water in the neighborhood, the presence of humans because that's a food source. These are high-risk areas. You also have some medium-risk areas where not all of these elements are present, even low-risk areas, areas with open grasslands, football fields, tennis fields. The mosquitoes won't breed there. They don't like to sit in open areas, so you don't need to place traps there. Next slide, please. So taking this into account will be a better option to calculate how many traps you will need. Then clean up or treat as many breeding sites as you can. The small breeding sites, try to remove them. It's always the best choice. If you can't remove them, try to treat them with, for example, dengue drops or BTI. If you have a small pond or a fountain, try to treat them with these elements. Same goes for the larger water bodies. If you have sort of a small lake on your property, then this might be the way forward. All the smaller breeding sites, like the axils of the bromelia, these are the ideal locations our trap targets by using the mosquito to spread pyroxifen. And of course, look at your septic tanks because those are also breeding sites. Next slide, please. Then place your mosquito traps. The traps work best if you place them in the shade. In the sun, it becomes really hot. Water will evaporate faster, and mosquitoes don't like open sunlit places. The Aedes aegypti doesn't. Place them near the water sources and in places that have active breeding sites before. Like I mentioned, mosquitoes have a memory. So if you remove the other breeding sites and place our trap as a substitution, you will enhance the effect of the trap. The number of traps and the surfacing. Surfacing must be done every 4 to 6 weeks. And surfacing consists of adding water or replacing water and a new piece of netting around the floater. In hotspots and high-risk areas, you can place more than one trap per 400 square meters. That's a 20 by 20 meter grid. And medium-risk areas, only one, and less than one to zero in low-risk areas. If there is a possibility for influx, then try to use barrier treatments as well. I will give some example how that would look like. Next slide, please. The last step would be then to monitor and maintain the traps with the refills. So change the netting and refill the water every 4 to 6 weeks. Monitor the traps. Sometimes you have a place that it has is in the shade during half of the day, but the other half is in the sun. So then your evaporation might go a little bit faster. Water can be filled up on top of the lid very easily, but check the water level. Check also the level of activity in the trap. If there are larvae and eggs in the trap, that's perfect. Then it's really working well. If there is no activity, try to place the trap elsewhere because then this is not a preferred breeding site for mosquitoes. If there are other species present as well, you might think of changing your methods or adding other measures as well. And of course, if you have broken or missing traps, you need to replace them. Next slide, please. things what is are important to consider for our trap is that the impact reached by our trap takes some time to build up because we are targeting the eggs and the larvae and kill the adult only in 7 days or so, 7 to 10 days. So it will generally take up to 2 to 3 weeks before you see a very noticeable difference. Also, it does not offer immediately personal protection. If you're standing next to the trap, then and a mosquito is searching for a blood meal, they will bite you and then go in the trap, but they won't go in the trap first. The ingredients, especially the fungus, has a limited stability, so after 2 months you really need to replace your refill, so that's why we said 4 to 6 weeks. Which is important for your customers as well and your clients and guests are to explain that live larvae, when present in the trap, that are actually a good thing. We had a case where in Aruba they thought that our trap was a active breeding site, so they fined the hotel, and so we had to explain it that it is really a good thing that they see. Once they did that, they were convinced. Once we showed that, and which is quite important for you to know, that the Integrated trap is complementary to all other mosquito control solutions, even the top-down solutions, which are often initiated by the governments, like the genetically modified mosquitoes or Wolbachia-infected mosquitoes. These are generally methods that the government decides. So if your government decides to do it, this will probably mean that they will ask you to stop fogging because you will kill the beneficial mosquitoes as well. You can still place our traps because they work in synchrony with all these elements. So this might be your solution and help to aid the government in their control efforts. Next slide, please. In the next slide, what I will show you, and that's a picture, so it will take some time, is an example of a very large resort in Jamaica. It stretches 2 kilometers coastline, but it gives me the perfect example to explain how to place our traps and how to calculate a little bit. You can do it with overlaying grids if you don't know the actual size, and use Google Earth to just calculate a little bit in rough estimation on the traps needed. Next slide, please. I will break down this whole resort in about 4 elements. So 4 parts, and we'll discuss them in a little bit more detail. Next slide, please. The first slide is really a part where you have all the small bungalows for the guests. And what I've shown, what you will see is small red dots, which indicate here, which indicate the placement of the traps, where we place them, often about, and taking into account your 20 by 20 meter grids. The red bars are the potential elements for a barrier treatment. You see on the left side a strip of green. This is an ideal place to use your barrier treatment. On the bottom side you will see a road. The road itself is already 40 meters wide. If you then use about 20 meters strip of the forest, then you have a very, very good barrier, making your hotel or resorts a isolated area where you can actually kill mosquitoes. Next slide, please. The next slide will show you pockets of high-risk areas, low-risk areas. Intention would be in the red areas to place a little bit more traps than 1 per 400 square meters. The yellow areas are areas that sometimes you have people there or humans there, so 1 per 400 square meters is okay, but you see also a lot of open areas in between, or even in the lower right corner you see a very strip of green or a small forest. They won't breed in the forest because they really want to be close to humans. So you don't need to place traps there. You will also see a pond around in the middle. That's an ideal location for your, you can't remove it, so to treat it with a aquatane formulation or a BTI tablet or anything. Next slide, please. The next slide is also you see it's a large part that was a forest area, so you don't need to place traps there. You have some inhabited areas there. On the left side, so these are quite good to place a higher number of traps. I have a small orange part there next to the larger ponds or small lakes, because that's an ideal target area to place some traps there. And in the right lower corner, you will see this is a part of a shopping mall. And shopping mall, that means that probably you have a higher chance of getting garbage on the ground, which can often lead to a small breeding site for aedes. So placing your traps there would be a very good thing. Next slide, please. Now we're coming to the last site of the hotel resort. Again, you have the villas here. People can rent, place one or two traps for the villa and around it. Barrier treatments in the bottom, and on the side you have again a small strip of green. Putting your barrier treatment there will isolate your whole resort. Next slide, please. The next slide is a much smaller hotel, but it can have, of course, the same type of problems. This is the Aqua Beach Hotel in Barbados, where in total we would place around 20-25 traps. The grids show where we would place the traps, a little bit around it, and also one or two in the middle. Next slide, please. The next slide will show you the inside of the hotel, where there's a lot of the pool, of course. Mosquitoes won't breed in that water. It's chlorinated often, or salt, but even then it's constantly moving, so they won't breed in that. But they will breed in the shrubs, in the vegetation close to the hotel. These are ideal because there's water nearby, the food sources there, so placing your traps there would be very good. Next slide, please. And next slide, it just shows the placement of the traps, how we would do it, and your red elements show where we would place a barrier treatment if necessary. That's how we would envision the implementation of our trap. Thank you for your attention.
Hey, Jana?
Yes, hello?
Hi, I think
hi there. Can everybody hear me now? Sorry about that. Alrighty. So now we're going to go into our question and answer section of the webinar. So gentlemen, please unmute your phones, all three of you. And many of our attendees have already submitted questions via chat. If you haven't done so yet, please go ahead and do so right now. And we're going to get started. I guess the gentleman, just whoever wants to answer, just speak up. Our first question is there a difference or preference in terms of efficiency between organic and chemical products? Who wants to tackle that one?
I'm not sure I understand the question. I'd be happy to answer. Is there a difference in efficiency?
Is there a difference or preference, in regards to efficiency, between organic and chemical products? Is one more efficient than the other?
Yeah, okay. I think, you know, we sell both types of products, so hopefully I'm coming from an unbiased area. Generally, the organic or the chemical products we talk to are going to be a little more efficient. They definitely will last longer. So for the dollar spent, the standard products, the lambda silos, the demand, the polyzone, et cetera, they're probably going to be a better choice. And I'm talking specifically on barriers. It's probably going to be a better choice. There are other things. There's garlic oils. We have all kinds of other stuff that we can offer up. But they generally are more repellent. They will kill, but they don't last quite as long. I hope that answers the question.
I hope so too. Okay, let's see. Moving on to the next question. What fogger can be used for houses near hotels? The equipment is too large for a house, correct?
I think we mentioned, Adriana, Ted had mentioned the lithium battery powered fogger, which is the Boston fogger, and that backpack unit is ideal for that situation. If there is a slightly larger area that they want to treat, let's say like around the house, there might be a golf course. You have so many options, but there's a mini light, a ULV fogger from Dynafog, which can be mounted, for example, like on a golf cart. But if you're going to be you know, walking around the house doing treatments, then we would highly recommend the Boston Fogger, the backpack type unit that was shown in the presentation.
Let me offer up another option too. I know, in addition to just exactly what Raoul said, there's, if you're looking to mist or do a barrier, the Boston Fogger is a good or what they call Boston Fogger, but it's a misting system. You can also use a hand tank sprayer for very small areas, as long as you get the particles as fine as you can with the spray, and you're kind of tilting the nozzle up. They can be used in hand tanks for small areas around houses, things like this. So that is a possibility. As far as a true fogger, there are very small or smaller, much less expensive foggers, electrical. One has a cord on it by Hudson, etc. That'll actually do a fogging material for knocking down mosquitoes. If you're talking about knocking down the adulticides and not so much the mist barrier. So yes. Long answer to a short question. There are other options for small areas.
Great. Okay. Our next question is, how does the fogging affect guests at a property? Would it be advisable to let them know? And what's the time frame that they should stay inside if they have to stay inside? Does it matter one way or the other?
All right. I'll go ahead and capture that one. Fogging, the materials that we've got, particularly, I'll go with permethrin. Permethrin is used in a lot of different things. So I don't want to say everything, like I said, everything is toxic in some amount, or everything has a safety factor in some amount. Permethrin is used on animals, on food, all kinds of different things. It's been around for a long time. So the effect on guests as far as the toxicity is very, very, very low. Obviously, no one wants to, you should be cognizant of where your guests are at and be careful where you're fogging, etc. But as far as the guest exposure, there's very, very little chance of a permethrin having an issue. You still want to fog and arrange to fog when guests, and that's why fogging in the evening or at night is when most people do it. Even though the mosquitoes are less active, that's the time when the guests are not there. So it'll depend on your policy, and I'm not giving you a real definite answer, but it'll depend on the policy and when the guests are at, et cetera, but the products that you would fog with most cases, are usually pretty safe. They will have an odor to them, but they are usually, I say safe, they're relatively non-toxic because of the extended use. The pyrethrin in particular, it comes from a chrysanthemum. It's basically a chrysanthemum grown all over the world, originally from South Africa. But it's derived from a chrysanthemum. It lasts very short, has very quick knockdown, and it's been used since, in the 40s, I believe. We've been using pyrethrin. It's a natural knockdown pyrethrin type product. So that can be used too. A little more expensive, but can be used too if there's a concern there.
Okay. A related question is regarding any possible health effects, particularly on infants or pets. And there's a question as well regarding whether there's been some kind of connection between insecticides and cancer.
That's a big broad question. Every like I said, the dose makes the toxin, whether it be aspirin, salt, or a pest control product, all have some degree of effect, oncogenicity or carcinogenicity. They all have some effect on different species. The ones that we use have had, many, many years, and I'm fair to say probably over $200 million in testing to be able to come on the market, because what we sell are EPA-approved products, and to do that, there's a lot of money that goes into it. We can get you information on particular products that, as far as the their toxicity level, but even natural products. It would cause some level of problem in high enough dose. The doses that we got are usually have 100 or 1,000 X safety factor before they're approved. The other thing I wanted to say is that, again, the dose makes the toxicity, and that's kind of an important concept to keep in mind, because you can drink, almost anything will cause a problem in the right dose.
Okay.
It's too broad of a question because everything is a little bit different than everything else and had different results. But should there be a question, whether it be lambda or permethrin, et cetera, we'd be happy to do it. I will say on permethrin, though, we want to keep permethrin away from cats. Dogs, no problem. It's actually in dog drops that you can put on dogs. Permethrin actually was in the lice and tick shampoos. It's safe enough, or was safe enough to do that. But on cats, they have a sensitivity to, so you would want to keep permethrin away from cats.
Is there a negative effect on other valuable insects, other maybe desirable ones, butterflies or things like that, that will be affected by the fogging?
Oh, you want to try that?
Yeah, well, you know, the key thing about this is, first of all, following label guidelines. So, you know, your mixing rates and everything, you need to rigidly adhere to that. But there are some new products coming on the market, for example, like Zenivex. When the spray solution dries, it is very kind to bees. And, of course, you generally mosquitoes do not really dwell, you know, amongst flowering plants, et cetera, where bees visit. So time of day of application, following rigidly the label guidelines, in terms of the strength of you know, concentration of the product that you're using and mixing and diluting it, is really, really key to avoid hitting non-targets.
Yeah, I might make one more comment on that, and that's where the In2Care trap becomes a very, very useful for a lot of reasons. One, it works really well, and we've seen some really, really good results with it. But the trap itself, if you think about it, you're using a natural fungus, plus you're using a growth regulator that's approved and put in drinking water, and you're putting it in a very point source, very small area, in particular that trap. So that's why that trap, you know, the In2Care trap works. And we call it a trap. It should be better named. This is a dissemination device, system, whatever you want to use. But that's why that would be a very, very good option if there was concern for guests and the chemical, or because you're going to get guests, they're going to ask the question. They always do. And it's their right to. That's why the In2Care works would be a very, very good choice in a lot of these situations.
And
maybe to add on to that, is that if you look at, for example, toxicity, Ted already mentioned it, everything is can be lethal. So you need to go to various testings before you can actually put your product onto the market. One of the most toxic tests they want to do is if a child eats it or drinks it. And so they tested that with rats. If you take your common table salt, you need to take about 3 grams per kilogram of body weight, and then it's already toxic. Your pyroxyfen, for example, you need to take more than 5 grams. So it's much safer than your average table salt already. So that it really is a dose-dependent thing. But still, these are quite non-toxic elements.
Okay. Let's see, I have a couple of questions now that I think Dr. Stewart can answer, because they're regarding In2Care traps. A lot of people are asking where they can purchase them, which countries they're available in, and what the average cost of a trap is.
I think I can pass half of this question, I think, back to Univar. Univar is for us the distributor for the Americas and the Caribbean area.
Wonderful.
And they have their pest control operators around the in almost every country, I guess. I can show the slide again, but in the presentation you will see the countries where we are registered, and even on the Univar site, all the countries there I think are mentioned.
Wonderful. Okay.
Maybe Raoul, you can take the pricing part.
Absolutely. How Univar does something, we work through our country dealers. So, for example, like in Barbados, the person that will be retailing these traps is Massey Trade in Barbados. And we have a lot of supplemental information which will follow this webinar. You know, in the event, we have our contact information up there. In the event that you're in a specific island or territory, you can always pop us an email and we will refer you to the person that can supply you with the traps. These traps retail generally, well, again, it's based on import duties for specific islands, but they generally range at a retail price between maybe 20 US, 25 US dollars at the retail level. And the sachets probably go for about 9 US dollars at the retail level. Again, it's based on individual import tariffs or duties, specific territories. But the traps are widely available in the Caribbean from far south as Guyana and Suriname, all the way through the island chains, Eastern Caribbean, the Western Caribbean. We just had approval in Jamaica, so the traps are generally available in most of the Caribbean islands, including the Dominican Republic and now Puerto Rico.
Wonderful. Okay, and now we're going to, actually, this is our last question. We have a couple more. These will be emailed to our presenters so that they'll have an opportunity to answer you directly via email. But this is going to be the last question for the day. With regards to integrated mosquito management, can methods like adulticiding and fogging interfere with the effectiveness of other control systems like in2care traps? If so, what other control methods should be used in conjunction with one another?
Shall I take a part of that? Maybe
yes.
Raoul, you can add. Because we are, the in2care trap targets the females when they are want to lay their eggs. Actually, like I mentioned in the presentation, it you can use any other element around it. If you use ultralight fogging, because what you will do is you will lower the population of flying adults, which is beneficial, especially for your guests. So please do use that if you have an acute problem. Any other methods, because it's a container, it's a contained, it's a point source for the trap. You can use any other element in mosquito control next to using the in2care traps.
Wonderful. Well, we're at the end of our webinar. I'd just like to remind you all before we leave that the presentation as well as the video recording of this webinar will be available to you in 48 hours. We will email it to you directly, but it will also be available on our website, www.caribbeanhotelandtourism.com. Gentlemen, thank you so much for taking the time to educate us on this very, very relevant, important topic. And thank you all for joining us.
Our pleasure.
A pleasure. Thank you very much.
Have a wonderful
day.
And also another thank you to our strategic partner, OBM International, for sponsoring this webinar. Everyone have a wonderful day, and thanks again for joining us.